Good morning, and welcome to New Hanover County Schools The Morning Show. I'm Hannah Bolick.
And I'm Allison Helms. This is the week of November 28th through December 4th.
Today's show celebrates Thanksgiving, and we have a special feature packed with fun facts you may not know about the holiday.
And it's our pumpkin show. It's a tradition here on The Morning Show that each year we dedicate one show to that seasonal symbol that tastes so delicious, especially in pie form.
We have a lot of interesting pumpkin facts and information, and even a pumpkin game.
And we take a look ahead in NC happenings. We will tell you about several fantastic upcoming events taking place across the state.
It's going to be an exciting show, but first, let's check in with our news anchor, Tyler Dawson. He's standing by with the morning's news headlines. Good morning, Tyler.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome everyone to your school news here in the morning show. Topping the headlines this week, Virgo students use STEM to battle zombie apocalypse. Trash launches Heart and Soul Girls on the Run program, and principals stuff food bags for Nourish NC. I'll have all those stories and more coming up later in the show.
Thanks, Tyler.
Okay, get ready to laugh because it is time for our joke of the week.
Students in Ms. Clayton's Honors Drama class at Ashley High School have performed these jokes for the morning show.
Now you can start each day off with a dose of humor.
Here's our joke of the week.
So there's this man named Marvin, and unfortunately Marvin was in the hospital on his deathbed. So the family called in Marvin's preacher to be with him in his final moments. The preacher stood by Marvin's bed and noticed that his condition seemed to deteriorate, and suddenly Marvin motioned for someone to quickly get him some pen and paper. So the preacher went, got the pen and paper, and lovingly handed it to Marvin. Marvin rapidly began jotting something down, but before anyone could read the note, Marvin died. The preacher, feeling that now wasn't the right time to read the note, just stuffed it away in his jacket pocket for now. It wasn't until at the funeral, when the preacher was speaking, that he suddenly remembered the note. And the preacher said, "And you know what? I suddenly remembered that in Marvin's final moments, he wrote me a note. And knowing Marvin, I'm sure it's something so inspirational that we can all gain from." So the preacher retrieved the note from his jacket pocket, opened it up, and read it aloud. And the note said, "Hey, you're standing on my oxygen tube."
Another amusing joke. Thank you, Ashley Honors Drama.
And now it's time for a staple here on The Morning Show, This Week in History. Our Grandmaster of Historical Knowledge has all the headlines from past times in This Week in History, brought to you by Kidsville News.
Welcome to This Week in History. I am your historical host, William Shaker, covering all the colorful and amazing events that have left their mark on history's timeline. This is the week of November 28th through December 4th. November 28th, 1895. On this Thanksgiving Day, piloting a gas-powered horse's carriage, the mechanic, inventor, and now race car driver Frank Duryea wins the first motor car race in the United States. November 29, 1947. Despite strong Arab opposition, the United Nations votes for the participation in the Palestine and creation of the independent Jewish state. November 30, 2004. After winning 74 straight games and more than $2.5 million, a record for U.S. game shows, Jeopardy contestant Ken Jennings loses. Jennings' extended winning streak gave the game show a huge rating boost. December 1, 1913, Henry Ford installs the first moving assembly line for the mass production of the entire automobile. His invention reduced the time it took to build a car from more than 12 hours to 2 hours and 30 minutes. December 2, 1823, President James Monroe proclaims a new U.S. foreign policy initiative that becomes known as the Monroe Doctrine. It forbade European interference in the American hemisphere, but also asserted U.S. neutrality in regard to the future European conflicts. Finally, your weekend history tidbits. December 3rd, 1947, Marlon Brando's famous Cry of Stella first booms across the Broadway stage, electrifying the audience during the first ever performance of Tennessee Williams' plays A Streetcar Named Desire. December 4th, 1867, Oliver Kelly founds The Grange, which becomes a powerful political force among the Western farmers. The Grange political activism resulted in the legislation that became known as the Granger Laws. That's This Week in History, your ultimate source for those key moments in time. I'm William Shaker. Thanks for stopping by.
This Week in History is brought to you by Kidsville News, a fun and effective learning resource for children, teachers, and parents. Kidsville News is always free. Copies are delivered every month to every elementary school in the New Hanover County School System.
And join us again next time for another Journey Through Time as we explore the fun, fascinating, entertaining, and educational facts that make up This Week in History.
We have plenty more of the morning show ahead, including Science Nation in this week's lunch menu.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
April.
Yeah?
You know your charger's still using energy when it's plugged into the wall, right?
Yeah, but that's not my charger. I don't even have a cell phone.
Millions of kids are using their energy wisely. What's your excuse?
Sounds like you could use some Van Gogurt. It's fortified with arts-rich nutrients to improve your math and reading skills. Catch!
Van Gogurt, thanks. So what's the deal with your ear?
Always with the ear, huh?
Feed your kids the arts. For 10 simple ways to learn how, visit AmericansForTheArts.org.
And I'd like you to watch this anti-drug message. Thanks.
If you don't do drugs, you can do great things.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Hannah Bolick.
And I'm Allison Helms.
We continue today's show with a fun facts feature on Thanksgiving.
On the fourth Thursday in November, families across the U.S. gather to feast on turkey, watch football, and gear up for Christmas by looking for Santa during the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. But did you ever wonder why these Thanksgiving traditions started?
Listen closely, and you can use these fun facts to impress visiting family and friends with your knowledge of the Thanksgiving holiday.
Fun fact, the first Thanksgiving was held in autumn of 1621 and included 50 pilgrims and 90 Wampanoag Indians, and it lasted 3 days. Many historians believe that only 5 women were present at the first Thanksgiving, as many women settlers did not survive that first difficult year. Interesting fact, Thanksgiving did not become a national holiday until over 200 years later. Sarah Josephia Hale, the woman who actually wrote the classic song, Mary Had a Little Lamb, convinced President Lincoln in 1863 to make Thanksgiving a national holiday. This was after writing letters for 17 years campaigning for the holiday. Did you know there was no turkey on the menu at the first Thanksgiving? Historians say that no turkey was served, but instead the menu consisted of deer, duck, geese, oysters, lobster, eel, and fish. They probably ate pumpkins, but no pumpkin pies. They also didn't eat mashed potatoes, but most likely had cranberries. Fun fact, no forks at the first Thanksgiving. The first Thanksgiving was eaten with spoons and knives, but not forks. Forks were not introduced to the Pilgrims until 10 years later, and they weren't popular until the 18th century. Super fun fact, Thanksgiving is the reason for TV dinners. In 1953, Swanson had so much extra turkey, over 250 tons, that a salesman told them they should package it into aluminum trays with other sides like sweet potatoes, and thus the first TV dinner was born. Can you believe it? Thanksgiving was almost a fast, not a feast. The early settlers gave thanks by praying and abstaining from food, which is what they planned on doing to celebrate their first harvest. That is, until the Wampanoag Indians joined them and turned the fast into a three-day feast. Silly fact. Each year, the President of the U.S. pardons a turkey and spares it from being eaten for Thanksgiving dinner. The first turkey pardon ceremony started with President Truman in 1947. President Obama pardoned the 45-pound turkey named Courage, who was flown to Disneyland and served as Grand Marshal of the park's Thanksgiving Day Parade. Speaking of parades, here's our parade fact. The Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade began in 1924 with 400 employees marching from Covenant Avenue to 145th Street in New York City. No large balloons were at this parade, as it only featured live animals from the Central Park Zoo. Interesting fact, President Abe Lincoln said Thanksgiving would be the fourth Thursday in November. But in 1939, President Roosevelt moved it up a week, hoping to help the shopping season during the Depression era. It never caught on and it was changed back 2 years later. Football fact, the NFL started the Thanksgiving Classic game in 1920, and since then, the Detroit Lions and the Dallas Cowboys have hosted games on Turkey Day. In 2006, a third game was added with different teams hosting. Speedy facts. Wild turkeys can run 20 miles per hour when they are scared. Benjamin Franklin wanted the turkey to be the national bird, not the eagle. Americans eat nearly 50 million turkeys each Thanksgiving. Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin's first meal in space after walking on the moon was foil packets of roasted turkey. The heaviest turkey on record, according to the Guinness Book of Records, weighs 86 pounds. The average turkey for Thanksgiving weighs 15 pounds. And finally, female turkeys, called hens, do not gobble. Only male turkeys gobble.
Those were great. I can't imagine a Macy's Thanksgiving parade without balloons, though.
I know. I also think it's funny that Benjamin Franklin wanted the turkey to be the national bird. That's hard to imagine.
There are so many fun facts in history. They really make it an interesting subject.
They do.
It's time now for our first block of news. Let's send it over to Tyler Dawson, who has several great stories to report. Good morning, Tyler.
Good morning. And welcome to Your School News on the Morning Show. I'm Tyler Dawson. Our top story this week, the teachers at DC Virgo Preparatory Academy are working to spark an interest in science, technology, engineering, and math by linking STEM education to the things their students already love, like zombies. Given the popularity of the hit TV show The Walking Dead, a zombie apocalypse was just the key to getting the Virgo students to explore the math, science, and engineering that would save them from becoming brain food. We get this report from YSN reporter Bobby Blue.
The zombies are coming! The zombies are coming! At DC Virgo Preparatory Academy, teachers tapped the undead to help them bring to life science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, better known as STEM.
And we came up with this thought process as a school. We said, you know what? Zombies. Because you can pull in literature through stories, and you can look at outbreaks over time. You could look at where the outbreak happens in a particular area and it spreads out as far as social studies go, like if more populated areas versus non-populated areas. Math could look at that exponential growth factor.
During the week of STEM-based zombie lessons, students took their fictional zombie attack as an opportunity to learn about actual public health issues, how the brain works, the best way to alert the public to danger, and more.
I think I like the geography and social studies because I love social studies, and I think it was interesting because I got to learn about a place that I haven't really heard of or really been interested in until now.
In many classes, Zombie Virus Inoculation Task Force were set up to figure out how they could control and contain the outbreak, just as if they were employees of the Center for Disease Control and Prevention.
Each kid had a sample of, we called it body fluid liquid, and they got to exchange those liquids with each other. And then at the end, I came around with our zombie indicator, and if theirs turned pink, then they were infected. If it turned orange, then they were not infected. We had to then take all of their data, so then I told them to take their patient hat off and put on their CDC hat, and now let's try to see if we can figure out patient zero.
Students in math classes used zombie disease outbreak simulators, which forced them to use money management to control resources to contain the outbreak, while others tried to predict the spread of the outbreak using probability. Even the art department joined in the zombie madness.
Well, we've been drawing some still life, so we ended up incorporating bones instead of, our plan was flowers, but we did bones too, and made the connection to Georgia O'Keeffe, because Georgia O'Keeffe is famous for her bone paintings and drawings of flowers and paintings of flowers.
As the zombie population grew, students were forced to find ways to escape or become zombies themselves.
We actually worked on building a zip line as an escape route. We also did a bridge that they had to build in order to get across and to escape the zombies. And we also had to build a raft out of very simple household equipment that could actually support a weight in a body of water.
The students at DC Virgo were drawn in from day one to the zombie STEM-based lessons and took to blogging as part of their language arts lessons to write about their experiences.
We went over and designed our own prosthetic leg. Then in reading class, we coded with zombies.
We went outside and we played a game, and our teacher, if you get two stickers, like you have to like chase each other, if you get two stickers, then you get one big blue sticker and you're a zombie.
It gets us more involved and it grabs your attention because it's based on zombies and makes you more interested.
Create a place where we would go to if like zombies attacked. So we'd have a city, then we'd have a backup city. And then it was just really fun because then we get to research that city.
The teaching staff at the school really sparked the minds of their students, giving a week of lessons that allowed them to use science, technology, engineering, math, and so much more in a way that will stick with them in the months and years ahead. Reporting for Your School News, this is Bobby Blue.
Ogden Elementary received a grant from the Landfall Foundation for $3,500 for the purchase and installation of a new smart board in a special designed academics classroom. The objective of the grant was to implement smart board technology in the SDA daily living classroom. With the help of the new technology, it is hoped that students will enhance their social communication, functional academics, and motor skills. It is also hoped that with the new smart board, the staff will be able to improve student motivation to learn and participate, and increase instructional and planning time. Trask Middle Schools has launched their new Heart and Soul Girls on the Run program. Heart and Soul creates a positive, structured space for middle school girls to learn about themselves, explore new ideas, cultivate empathy, strengthen connections, and develop life skills that will help them as they move through adolescence and beyond. Trask Middle School's Heart and Soul curriculum is rich with themes girls can relate to, addressing the whole girl, body, brain, heart, spirit, and social connection, and building important life skills such as team building, developing a support system, boundary setting, decision making, asking for, and providing help, and more. This 10-week program is accessible to all Trask Middle School's girls, regardless of academic ability or fitness level, and considers the range of ages and varied experiences of the girls participating. The season culminates with the Girls on the Run 5K, which is the celebratory event that underscores the confidence, complacence, connection, and character and caring they've been developing in the program, and gives them a tangible sense of goal setting and achievement. For all the latest on New Hanover County Schools, join us weekdays at 5:30 p.m. here on Time Warner Cable Channel 5 and Charter Cable Channel 191 for your school news, a complete half hour of all the latest news and information from New Hanover County Schools. Now back to our hosts.
Thanks, Tyler. In addition to watching your school news in the morning show, you can see many of NHCS TV's programming online.
Just go to the school system's website at www.nhcs.net and click on the NHCS TV logo right there on the front page.
You can watch great programs there, such as the Sports Roundtable, the Forum, and Upfront with the Superintendent.
It's an excellent way to watch our programming whenever you want.
Shifting gears now, we continue our show with Science Nation from the National Science Foundation. This feature takes a dynamic, entertaining look at the research and the researchers that will change our lives.
From the latest inventions to studies that could change the way we perceive the world, each episode is packed with electrifying information.
Looks like a drinking straw, right? But the butterfly and moth proboscis, or mouth structure, is no simple sipper. And for materials scientist Kostya Kornev, it's nothing short of a bio-inspiration.
In a single fiber, you have everything. You have sensors, you have transport system, so the material can be, and the liquids can be moved through that fiber. Okay, and the fiber performance is incredible.
With support from the National Science Foundation, Kornev and a team at Clemson University want to know more about how the proboscis works in order to make synthetic fibers with similar properties.
So the butterfly can coil uncoil proboscis million times during adult life.
Eventually, they want to build a proboscis-like microsiphon or probe. Using capillary action through channels and pores, it would suck up or dispense tiny drops of fluid. Such a device would have wide-ranging applications, like new medical tools.
So you can think about even poking the single cell, taking a little droplet from, say, the nucleus, or if you can go to the brain and do the surgery on the brain.
When you get a black swallowtail?
For butterfly and moth expertise, he turned to entomologist Peter Adler. They want to better understand how the proboscis develops.
The proboscis begins to form in the pupa. The insect has to transform from a caterpillar, which has no proboscis. It has very hard mandibles. So it has to transform to a butterfly that essentially loses its mandibles and instead, from other structures, forms this long tube-like proboscis.
Kornev and his team do tests in their lab to understand the proboscis properties. They found it works both like a straw and a sponge, and its surface properties make it self-cleaning. No sticky residue can gum up the works. It's actually made of two tubes that can come apart but naturally come back together, so self-repairing.
Now we are interested how that fiber is organized. Is it possible to break the fibers apart and then bring them together on their own? Can butterfly do that? And it appears that it can.
He says the challenge is to understand how the proboscis evolved in butterflies and moths over millions of years, then recreate that structure and performance in a man-made fiber.
If you would be able to produce the fibers on demand, just a little piece of material which could have all the sensors, all these mechanical devices, all these probing devices in one unit, that would be terrific.
Kornev is confident they will figure it out. With hard work, even challenging goals can take flight. For Science Nation, I'm Miles O'Brien.
That was another great segment from Science Nation.
It was. There are so many interesting science stories. I'm glad we feature a new episode of Science Nation each week.
I look forward to seeing more.
It's time for a quick break. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
It's always nice to come home, but many Americans are at risk of foreclosure and losing their homes. Making Home Affordable from the U.S. government has already helped over a million struggling homeowners like these. The sooner you act, the better chance we can help you.
I'm home, where I belong.
Yeah, you! Are you the weakest link at your bus stop?
Because you don't know the school bus safety rules.
When riding on the bus, stay in your seat. Don't stick anything out the windows. Listen to the bus driver, follow his or her directions. Talk quietly with your friends. Don't throw things in the bus.
Safety and the big yellow bus keeps everyone safe and sound.
Our story begins with a journey for knowledge. For research indicates that when a parent takes a more active role in their child's quest for education, that child will be bestowed with higher grades and higher sense of being. Just a wee bit of time out of your meeting schedule is all it takes to show your allegiance.
Hear what your kids are saying. Get more involved. Join your local PTA.
Welcome back to the Morning Show.
Thanksgiving is a time for family and friends to gather, and food usually comes to mind. Lots of food, in fact. However, it should also be a time where we reflect on all that we have.
To get a glimpse of what students thought about being thankful, we made it the focus of our Students' Voices segment.
Each month, we poll students on their thoughts from a host of questions. These questions range from local and national current events to topics that are just for fun. We featured their answers in a segment we call Student Voices.
This month, we traveled to Trask Middle School and asked students what are they thankful for? And here's what they had to say.
I'm thankful for a wonderful education, and I'm thankful that we can laugh, because if we couldn't laugh, it would be a very sad place or a very sad world. And one more thing that I'm thankful for is supportive teachers and supportive parents and wonderful friends here at Trask Middle School.
I'm thankful for not only my health and wellness, but I'm also thankful for having a good school with good teachers that are very supportive and parents that love and care about me more than anything.
I'm thankful for my family, my friends, the home that I live in, and my life in general.
I'm thankful for having great friends, family, relatives, teachers, and being able to live in the United States of America.
I am thankful for family, friends, and my teachers.
I am thankful for my friends, my family, and my food.
I am thankful for not being hit by Hurricane Matthew, having a roof over my head, having food to eat, and having good teachers.
I am thankful for the plentiful resources that we have here at Trask, such as a good book variety and a clean gym. And I'm also thankful for my supportive parents helping me through this Trask Middle School experience.
I'm thankful for my family, my friends, and my education, because my family is really nice to me and they take care of me.
I'm thankful for getting the education that I need, because people around the world don't get education that we do.
I am thankful for friends, family, and this wonderful education here at Trask Middle School.
I am thankful for everything, because if we had nothing, we would not even be here.
And I'm thankful for life,
Jesus died on the cross for my sins, and a school to go to for education.
And I'm thankful for my loving friends and my parents, because my friends are very sweet and nice to me, and they always care about me, and so do my parents.
Thank you, Trask and Principal Dr. Rollison. Allison, what are you thankful for?
I'm thankful for my closest friends. What about you, Hannah?
I would say my family.
We hope everyone spends some time this Thanksgiving thinking about what they are thankful for.
And we hope you all have a relaxing and enjoyable Thanksgiving break.
All right, it's time now for this week's lunch menu. Here are your delicious items your cafeteria will be serving. So go ahead and plan your lunchtime meals.
On Monday, November 28th, your cafeteria will be serving chicken and cream soup with cornbread, French bread pizza, or deluxe chicken sandwich. Also chow down on garden peas, glazed sweet potatoes, and mixed fruit. On Tuesday, November 29th, treat yourself to spaghetti and meatballs with a breadstick, a barbecue pork sandwich, or barbecue chicken with a biscuit. Complement your meal with lima beans, green beans, and diced pears. On Wednesday, November 30th, end the month the right way with a Philly cheesesteak or cheesy breadsticks or a turkey and cheese wrap for lunch. Satisfy your hunger with pasta salad, vegetable soup, and a frozen fruit cup. On Thursday, December 1st, choose from delicious chicken pot pie, steamy macaroni and cheese with a roll, or a juicy cheeseburger. Also enjoy side items of crunchy carrot sticks, roasted herb potatoes, and mixed fruit. On Friday, November 2nd, satisfy your need to feed with beef enchiladas, scrumptious chicken egg rolls with fried rice, or corn dog nuggets. Round the meal out with oriental vegetables and diced peaches. On Monday, December 5th, sit down with your friends and enjoy chicken nuggets with rice and gravy, a yummy fish fillet sandwich, or delectable hot dog with cheese. Complement your entree with macaroni salad, a sweet potato, and diced pears.
And there you have the lunch menu for the week. In addition to those items, milk, a garden salad, fresh fruit, French bread pizza, and a peanut butter and jelly combo will be available daily.
So many delicious choices. Don't forget, you can also start your day off with a healthy and hearty breakfast at school.
Now, this time of year, the pumpkin reigns among food. From jack-o'-lanterns at Halloween to the famed Thanksgiving Day pumpkin pie.
Pumpkins are believed to have originated in North America. Seeds from related plants have been found in Mexico dating back to 7,000 to 5,500 BC.
References to pumpkins date back many centuries. The name pumpkin originated from the Greek word for large melon, which is pepon. Pepon was changed by the French to pompon. The English changed pompon to pompion. American colonists changed pompion into pumpkin.
Native American Indians used pumpkin as a staple in their diets centuries before the Pilgrims landed. They also dried strips of pumpkins and wove them into mats. Indians would also roast long strips of pumpkin on the open fire and eat them. When settlers arrived, they saw the pumpkins grown by the Indians, and pumpkins soon became a staple in their diets too.
As today, early settlers used them in a wide variety of recipes, from desserts to stews and soups. The origin of pumpkin pie is thought to have occurred when the colonists sliced off the pumpkin top, removed the seeds, and then filled it with milk, spices, and honey. The pumpkin was then baked in the hot ashes of a dying fire.
The leading county of pumpkin production is Floyd County, Texas. They grow about 1 million pumpkins a year and celebrate with Pumpkin Day on the second Saturday of October. However, the citizens of Morton, Illinois calls their town the pumpkin capital of the world because Libby has its own pumpkin industry and plant there.
The pumpkin has become universal and are grown all over the world on 6 of the 7 continents, with Antarctica being the sole exception. They're even grown in Alaska.
And there you have our pumpkin overview.
I hope you were paying attention, as some of that information may come up later in the show.
For now, everyone get a pen and paper ready. Another new addition to the morning show is here, and it is going to make you think. Our morning show math question is a challenging problem for you to solve at home. We'll give you the question now and then solve it for you after a break. So put on your thinking caps and get ready to solve our question, because here it is. Okay, we hope you got that down. Spend a minute working it out, and we will have the answer after this short break.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Advisor is being accused of committing one of the largest investment frauds in the history of the United States.
I guess we're not going to Aspen. That's fine. You see, I like tennis balls. He likes insider trading. So he's going to jail and I'm going to a shelter. And no, they're not the same thing. Shelters are for good pets that want to be adopted. Jails are for criminals. I've done nothing. Uh-oh. Okay, I stole a cheeseburger once. I'm a dog.
My cell phone number and John's cell phone number. Hey, pretty. And number of the restaurant where we're going to be. And I've left you my pager number too, just in case, because you never know. John, you have the gift?
The odds of a babysitter calling 911, 1 in 1,400.
So if anything should happen, please don't hesitate.
The odds of a child being diagnosed with autism, 1 in 150. You know the odds of autism. Now learn the signs. Go to autismspeaks.org.
Hi, I'm Sheila E. Music is vital to a quality education for every child in America. Children who study music do better in school and in their lives. Music in school keeps children in school. It gives you confidence, it's inspiring, and it just makes you feel good. Please get involved in your community and help make sure that music is part of every child's education. To learn how you can help, please visit www.supportmusic.com.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Hannah Bolick.
And I'm Allison Helms.
Before the break, we showed you our morning show math question.
Were you able to solve it correctly? Here is Elizabeth Crace, math teacher at Murray Middle School, with the solution.
Good morning. Today we're going to use do some math problems involving decimals. There's a rule to know about decimals. When you add and subtract decimals, you have to make sure to line up your decimals. So here's your problem. James had $40 and he spent $12.25 on what he had for lunch. How much does James have remaining? Well, if James has $40, I know that I can add a decimal point and two zeros at the end. And then he also spend $12.25. What's really important when adding and subtracting decimals is to line up your decimal. So I'm going to put $12.25. And if I want to know how much he spent, this is what he started with. He spent this much for lunch. Now I want to know what he has remaining. So I'm going to subtract. Well, when I look at subtracting, 5 cannot go away from 0. So I'm going to have to borrow. When we borrow from math, we're going to cross this out. This becomes 10. This becomes 9. I couldn't borrow from here because it's 0, so I have to continue to try to borrow. I'm going to borrow from here, and I'm going to subtract from there. So now I should be able to do my math. So 10 minus 5 is 5. 9 minus 2 is 7. I'm going to bring down my decimal point. 9 minus 2 is 7, and 3 minus 1 is 2. So I'm left with $27.75. A helpful hint to see, especially when you're dealing with money, is to check your work. I should be able to add 2775 and 1225 back together and get back to my original amount of $40. So I'm going to just double check that really quickly because I want to make sure that I'm able and I have the right amount of money and I'm back to $40. Thanks, and now back to the studio.
We hope you enjoyed our morning show math problem and we got those brain juices flowing.
Each week we'll feature a new problem for you to solve.
It's time now for NC Happenings. Everyone should get out their pen and paper as we take a trip across the state and look at all the events taking place in the coming month.
Whether you're looking for adventure or relaxation, mountains or beaches, the rhythm of city life or the tranquility of nature, there's something happening for everyone here in North Carolina.
Date, December 2nd through 4th. Place, Burnsville. Event, Tow River Studio Tour. At the Tow River Studio Tour, you will find craftspeople and artists in nearly every medium. It's a self-guided trip that will lead you to some unique places between Mount Mitchell and Roan Mountain. Visitors travel through valleys, pass streams, cross rivers, climb hilltops, and experience breathtaking mountain vistas. Admission is free and it runs from 10 a.m. until 5 p.m. Visit towriverarts.org or call 828-682-7215 for more information.
December 9th through 11th. Place, Littleton. Event, 'Twas the Night Before Christmas, presented by the Lakeland Theater Company. Watch as the classic story unfolds as a grand Christmas adventure. It's a wild holiday adventures of a mouse, an elf, and a spunky little girl on their quest to find out why Santa missed their house last year. Admission is $16 for adults and $9 for students. The fun begins at 8 p.m. and lasts until 10 p.m. Friday and Saturday, and 2:30 p.m. to 4:30 p.m. Sunday. Call 252-586-3124, extension 3, or go online to lakelandtc.org for all the details.
Date, December 16th through 17th. Place, Winston-Salem. Event, Old Salem Candlelight Tour. See Old Salem with a tour guide by candlelight. The evening will include music, games, food, and drink. It also allows time for interacting with staff to learn more and create memories. It is recommended that you wear warm clothing and comfortable shoes. Please note, space is limited and pre-registration is required. Admission is $40 per person plus sales tax. For more information, visit the website oldsalem.org or call 336-721-7300.
Date, December 23rd. Place, Wilmington. Event, Christmas Train and Light Spectacular. Looking for something close by to before Christmas arrives? Try a family trip to this spectacular viewing treat as holiday magic returns to the Railroad Museum. See a seasonal wonderland with decorations, more than 20,000 lights that glisten and sparkle, as well as musical animations and twilight model train displays. Santa is also on hand with goodies and cider to sip. Cost is $5 per person and you can call 763-2634 or go to wrrm.org for all the details.
Date, December 31st. Place, Mount Olive. Event, 18th Annual Mount Olive's New Year Pickle Drop. The New Year's Eve pickle descends the flagpole at the stroke of 7 p.m. in lieu of midnight. The event is great family fun with live music and free refreshments and, of course, Mount Olive pickles. It starts at 5:30 p.m. and ends at 7:30 p.m. and admission is free. To learn all about it, call 919-658-2535 or go to their website, mtolivepickles.com.
If these events weren't enough for you or you were looking for something different to do, then check out the website www.visitnc.com. Under the upcoming events tab, you'll be able to sort and search for something that suits your need.
It's time for more Your School News, so let's send it back over to our news anchor, Tyler Dawson.
Thank you, and welcome everyone to Your School News here on The Morning Show. New Hanover County Schools principals kicked off their 2016 United Way District Campaign, the Warehouse of Norris and C. It wasn't a meeting focused on statistics or teaming with emotional appeal. Instead, it was a working meeting for a United Way charity that provides valuable service to the various students of the principal serves. Gathered around large tables lined with a variety of food items, the principals were initiated with the backpack program. Moving around the tables, principals stuffed bags with meals, snacks, and fresh produce like apples, oranges, sweet potatoes, and avocados, and more. These bags are the principals learned are delivered to the schools where social workers or family counselors discreetly put the food in the bags into the needy children's backpacks. The bags are provided every weekend and for all school breaks. During the packing of the bags, principals learn that sometimes the bags often contain extras like toiletries, winter hats and gloves, school supplies, healthy and easy recipes, holiday stockings stuffed with toys, and information on community resources. The program is provided at no cost to students or their families.
And the idea behind the backpack program is a lot of our children rely on free reduced lunch Monday through Friday, but they don't have access to good healthy food over the weekends. So what the principals did today was pack 300 bags for 300 kids to have 8 meals over this weekend. So when they show up to school Monday morning, they're happy, they're healthy, and they're ready and able to learn.
Norris NC was started in 2008 when a small group of concerned women discovered that children in their school were going hungry on weekends. These parents decided to take action and Norris NC was born. They funded a backpack program for 20 children at Carolina Beach Elementary School. News of the success spread quickly and the program expanded to a middle school in 2009. With widespread interest in the program, Norris NC took the steps to become a full-fledged nonprofit in 2010. During their time at the warehouse, the principal stuffed over 300 bags for the backpack program. With the help of GE Foundation grant and more than 250 volunteer hours from GE Hitachi Nuclear Energy and GE Aviation employees, New Hanover County's Cape Fear Museum opened a new space-themed learning center. Designed and fabricated in-house with help from GE employees, Space Place is an interactive experience inspired by and modeled after the International Space Station, a spacecraft that orbits Earth where astronauts from around the world live and work. A select group of students from Freeman Elementary were the first to get a chance to enter Space Place to use its hands-on STEM interactives. Things like a robotic arm, microscopic experiments, and a glove box challenge. Students discovered visual elements throughout the station offering real-time information about the International Space Station's location and daily operations. Freeman students even discovered how astronauts sleep in space, examine the water cycle aboard the space station, and engage in several rotating activities. Excited students learned a lot about the International Space Station. Through their time in Space Place, they were thrilled to hear and learn more about further space exploration. Finally, New Hanover County Schools is participating in a national Speak Up survey this year. The survey polls K-12 students, parents, educators, and community members about the role of the technology for learning and in and out of school. The goal of the Speak Up survey is to get as many students, teachers, community members, and parents to participate in the survey as possible. You are encouraged to access and take the survey today. Just head over to the school system's website, nhcs.org, and look for this Speak Up logo at the bottom of the page. Then follow the directions. The deadline for completing the survey is January 13th. That's all for now. To watch this week's edition of Your School News online, visit the school system's website at www.nhcs.net and click the NHCS TV logo on the homepage. Now back to our hosts.
Thanks, Tyler. For many, many years, various versions of tic-tac-toe have been played here on The Morning Show, and pumpkin tic-tac-toe is a yearly favorite.
I love tic-tac-toe.
Well, let the game begin. Let's send it back over to Tyler, who will explain the rules.
Here are the rules. I will ask a pumpkin-related question. If you get it right, you can mark the board in an open spot of your choosing. The questions will rotate back and forth. If we run out of questions or tie, the person with the most marks on the board wins. Hannah, you will mark the board with the uncarved pumpkins, and Allison, you will mark the board with the jack-o'-lanterns. I flipped a coin before the show, and Hannah, you get to go first. Okay, contestants, are you ready?
Yes.
All right, here we go. Pumpkins have been grown in North America for close to blank years. A, 500, B, 5,000, C, 50,000.
500?
Sorry, it's not right. It was 5,000.
Oh, well.
Pumpkins were probably served at what famous meal? A, the Last Supper, B, the First Thanksgiving, C, halftime at Super Bowl 30.
B, the First Thanksgiving.
That is correct. You mark the board.
I choose middle.
Said middle, middle.
Middle, middle.
You ready?
Yeah.
Pumpkins are a great source of nutrition. They are A, low in calories, fat and sodium, B, high in fiber with vitamin A, B, and potassium, or C, all of the above.
All of the above.
Okay, yeah.
Oh, nice,
okay.
Nice.
Okay.
Okay, I will take top left corner.
The largest known pumpkin in the world weighed A, 513 pounds, B, 1,061 pounds, or C, 3,211 pounds?
B.
Okay, yeah, that's right. Okay.
That's ridiculous. I choose top right.
Oh, it's getting pretty crazy. Okay. Pumpkins are members of the family cucumbercane, which also includes A, cucumbers, B, cauliflower, or C, broccoli. Let me say the question again.
Yes, please.
Pumpkins are members of the family cucumbercane, which also includes cucumbers, cauliflower, or broccoli.
Cucumbers?
Yeah.
Okay.
See, I don't know if that's pronounced that way, but kind of.
I just was hoping it wasn't a trick question. Right. Okay. I will take bottom left, whatever block.
Yeah, I would hope that you would take that.
Yeah.
Okay. True or false? Pumpkins contain potassium and vitamin A.
True.
That is right.
I choose middle right.
You got true or false here. pumpkin flowers are edible.
False?
It was true. It was true. Oh, okay. I got this.
Oh, well.
This is the question. It's a loaded question here. The largest pumpkin pie ever made was over 5 feet in diameter and weighed over 350 pounds. It used 80 pounds of cooked pumpkin, 90 pounds of cooked pumpkin, 60 pounds of cooked pumpkin, or 75 pounds of cooked pumpkin.
75 pounds of cooked pumpkin.
That's not right. It was 80 pounds of cooked pumpkin. Ooh. Pumpkins were once recommended for removing A, warts, B, bruises, or C, freckles.
Bruises?
It's Sorry, it was freckles. Pumpkins are 90% water, 70% water, or 60%
water? 70%
water. It was 90% water.
Okay.
Got some redemption here. You can get this question right, you can not lose.
Okay.
True or false? 80% of the pumpkin supply in the United States is available in October. It's 50-50.
How much percent?
80%.
True?
Yes.
Okay. Crazy. All right. Crazy. Well, I'll go for middle left.
Savage.
It's a miracle.
It would have been more exciting if you went like somewhere else.
We could have been here all afternoon.
All right. That's our game. The winner is Hannah. Congratulations. You are this year's pumpkin tic-tac-toe champion.
Good game, Hannah.
Good game, Allison. Well, that does it for this edition of The Morning Show.
For the best TV of all, each and every day, keep it tuned right here for New Hanover County Schools TV on the Learning Network of the Cape Fear.
Have a great day.
And a wonderful week.